Jamdeep Sewell. Hello, everyone. Virginia Touch here, and I welcome you back to this VOKK TV series to rediscovering and preserving the Khmer Krom identity. Due to the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic this year, the 14th session of the Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples was organized virtually from July 12th to July 16th. It is my pleasure to invite Priscilla Kim Ong once again to this TV series. She had represented KKF, Khmeres Kampucheakorom Federation, to deliver the statements of MRIP this year. She is here with us today to share her experience. Hello, Priscilla. It's nice to see you. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Thank you.
Great. So before starting my questions, I want to just first thank you for finishing your intern with KKF and also for volunteering with us, you know, this summer. Especially attending MRIP virtually. I do understand it was a two-hour session, yes. Starting 1 a.m. Pacific time, yeah. Meaning 10 a.m. in Geneva, so that was really late. So I know without that dedication and commitment, you know, staying up that late, it's kind of hard, you know, for a youth like you. So I wanted to thank you for that. So could you please share the topic of the sessions that you had brought up and let us know how many you had delivered?
Yeah, so this was the 14th session of the Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and there were two agenda items or topics. So the first was item 3, which was a draft study and advice on the rights of the Indigenous child under the UN Declaration of the Rights of the Child. And the second was item 8, which was the draft report on efforts to implement the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and the Indigenous Peoples and the Right to Self-Determination. And I was fortunately able to give two statements, one on each of the agenda items, and I was honored to be one of the youth who represented their organizations.
Great. So I'm glad, you know, within that two-hour session, glad that you were able to present, you know, both the statements. Could you please share with us the, you know, your main points that you had delivered?
Yeah, so on the rights of the Indigenous child, the focus was primarily on education. Our Khmer Krom children are left behind. Many of them do not finish school and end up working at a very young age to provide for their families because of the extreme poverty that they face, which must be met with systemic change. But what's even worse is that generations of our Indigenous children have seen how education doesn't serve them in the way that it should, and because of the oppression and discrimination that they face when looking for a job. So we asked MRIP to help conduct a study on this and develop a pilot project that focuses on Indigenous curriculum, including the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, specifically in our Khmer language, so that our Khmer Krom children know their rights and also are able to learn their Khmer language. We hope that their language can be taught in public schools as well to ensure that it lives on. And the second was on the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and we asked again that Vietnam finally recognize our Khmer Krom as Indigenous peoples so that our people can finally be free to exercise their right to self-determination and the right to self-identify as Khmer Krom. And so implementing UNDRIP in Vietnam would allow our Khmer Krom people to protect our culture and lay claim to their ancestral lands and support their traditional livelihood of farming. And so we also asked that Vietnam release Mr. Dep Huynh and drop the charges against him and the other farmers who were sentenced to prison for simply trying to farm and make a living on their land.
Perfect. So I know a lot of people all over the world have watched your video, so they can watch it again if they want, you know, to get in detail just the things you talked about and you just mentioned in this video. So, you know, your dedication and your passion really shows that you're continually, you know, helping our people. And I know that people back home are very proud and, you know, they're thankful for your dedication to bring all this to light, right? So I know the last time you did share with us that you were going to go to Vietnam abroad for school, but I do know some things have happened ever since then. So do you still plan on going? Is that still an option for you?
So unfortunately, the program was canceled because of the rising COVID cases in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, I won't be going, but I hope to go in the future once things are safer to do so.
Okay, I'm glad to hear. I mean, you know, it is sad to see on social media the outbreak of COVID-19 in Vietnam in recent days. The leaders of Vietnamese government, you know, used to be proud to tell the world about how good they were, you know, doing with COVID. Unfortunately, that has happened lately. There's been a lot of serious concerns that, you know, especially that affect our Khmer Krom people in the Mekong Delta, who are the poorest, you know, as we know. Have you been able to follow up about this outbreak, and do you have anything to share regarding COVID back in Campuchia Kurong?
Yeah, so the COVID situation in Vietnam is not only worsening, but Vietnam's response to it is arguably just as bad. We know that our Khmer Kurong people, like many other indigenous groups, are sadly not one of Vietnam's priorities. And we are seeing evidence of that as our people are forced to pay for COVID tests. And if they're suspected of being sick, they're forced to quarantine and cover the costs, which is about 70 to 90,000 dong, depending on the location, which to us may not seem like a lot of money, but for some of the poorest people in Vietnam, it really is. And so it's just very unfair and wrong to impose these financial burdens on people living in poverty during a pandemic. And so now the government even asked for our impoverished Khmer Krom to quote unquote help the government pay for the vaccines. So
yeah, so thank you for sharing, you know, your concerns about the impact of COVID-19 on our people. You know, I saw on social media that even the Vietnamese people in the South complained that the good vaccine from US and England was mainly distributed for the top leaders in the North, which is very unfortunate. Thus, as you mentioned, charging them, which adds to their financial hardships, right, to the poorest people in the Mekong Delta. You know, and I'm scared to say, like, will they even ever get the vaccine, right, all over, you know, in East Asia and just kind of in general. And the fact that the Vietnamese government, they see our people as second citizen, which is, that's another unfortunate, you know, adding to this.
Yeah.
Talking about communists, you might know about the recent protests of the Cubans to demand freedom in Cuba. Because they faced a tough time during the pandemic, I watched a video seeing the governor of Florida, Ron DeSantis, respond to Cuba's shutdown. On the internet on July 15th in Miami, he said that, in quote, "The one thing the communist regime fears the most is the truth. I know you were fortunate to be born in the U.S., as was I. So we did not go through the hardships as our parents, you know, back home." So as a young activist, do you agree with his comments, you know, about the communist regime?
Well, I would say, aside from the governor's political views and other statements, this one in particular is relevant to the ongoing situation in Cuba, as well as in Vietnam and other communist countries. It actually really reminded me of a book I read in high school called Animal Farm, which shows the contrast between capitalism and communism, which I often find myself comparing as an advocate for people living in a communist country, whereas I live in the US. And so last week, President Biden said that communism is a failed system, which seems to be true when regarding countries like Cuba or Vietnam, with the human rights abuses that the people face and the efforts that the government make to keep the truth hidden from the people. And so this is seen in Vietnam when our Khmer Krom youth tried to simply distribute the UNDRIP, ICCPR, and UDHR documents, which involve our rights, human rights. And so the Vietnam authorities, Vietnamese authorities, confiscated them to ensure that our people would not learn about their rights. And so in that sense, in a communist country like Vietnam, they really are trying to keep the truth from our people.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, I wanted to thank you for mentioning that and tying, you know, that quote to the book, because I think a lot of us throughout high school has read it. It's been a major book that we all should learn. And hopefully, you know, for those who haven't, I hope they do read that book. You know, I think it's important to highlight that the Vietnamese continue to push out and, you know, all these different avenues or resources that our people are trying to learn. They're not able to learn the basic human rights, which is, it's, how do we say back here, you know, we have freedom of speech and we have everything we can do, it's freedom, right? But back home, they are struggling. And I think the things that you are doing here, you know, that we're trying to do, hopefully it'll help and push, you know, for our people more back home to speak up as they are continuing to do. So I wanted to thank you for being here. And just, you know, do you want to say a last word or two to, you know, our viewers?
Sure, yeah, I think it's very important to also acknowledge, like, having been born in the U.S., being a U.S. citizen, recognizing the privileges that I have and the freedoms that I have, but also recognizing that we still have a lot of work to do here in the U.S. as well. And so I see, as I do this advocacy work for our Khmer Krom back in Vietnam, there's a lot of focus on the people around the world who are facing these human rights abuses, but some of these abuses are happening right here in the U.S. as well. So I definitely don't want to reduce that as well.
Perfect. So again, I'm proud of you. I can't wait to continue to work with you. And I look forward to talking to you again.
Thank you so much. Me too.
Okay. It is always my pleasure to talk to Priscilla, a young Khmer Krom activist. Her passion and commitment to seek justice for our voiceless Khmer Krom in Campuchia Krom And I hope that youths all around the world will be inspired, as I know she has made impacts to youths around her. I would like to conclude this video with a meaningful quote from a young activist, Ms. Melissa Ferry, about why youth voices matter in this world. End quote, "Youth voices matter because we are a generation of advocates, activists, and innovators who do not have the luxury of waiting to change the world we live in. We represent the future and the present with knowledge that nothing can happen for us without us." Som akon, jumriap liye. Thank you.